Next up, after all these information gathering and vulnerability analysis, we are now going to look into how the attacks can actually take place. So we will look into three attacks. First, we will start with SQL injection. Then we will start with cross-site scripting. And finally, DOS attacks. So what is SQL injection? As we all know, SQL is a structured query language. So SQL injection basically is a web security vulnerability that allows an attacker to interfere with the queries that an application makes to its database. It generally allows an attacker to view data that they are not normally able to retrieve. This might include the data belonging to the other users or any other data that the application itself is able to access. In many cases, an attacker can modify or delete this data, causing persistent changes to the application's content or even behavior. In some situations, an attacker can escalate an SQL injection attack to compromise the underlying server or other backend infrastructure, or even perform denial of service. So we are going to learn about what is SQL injection and how do we carry it in our practical sessions.
Welcome back. Well, which is the next topic? I guess you have guessed it correctly, which is SQL injection, right? The diagram is self-explanatory. Well, SQL stands for Structured Query Language. You all are aware of it. What is SQL injection? Well, it's sometimes even called as SQL injection. So whichever way you wish to call it, it's entirely up to you. As I just now iterated, SQL stands for Structured Query Language. So any relational database is made up of SQL queries, SQL tables, relations, schemas. So basically, SQL injection is a term which is consisting of series of attacks on relational databases using SQL statements. So first of all, see the actual definition of what is SQL injection and what are we going to do in this piece of experiment. The aim for us today is detect the SQL injection vulnerabilities in a website database using a tool which is called as SQL Map. So here the tool in consideration is SQL Map. For this, we are going to use the Kali machine. I've already shown you how to install a Kali machine in our very first video lecture, the prerequisites video. So if you are not aware of it, kindly go back to that particular video. So first of all, go through the installation process, how to install Kali machine on a local machine having either dual boot or a virtual machine setup. I will be using Kali in a virtual environment setup using Oracle VirtualBox. So let's see the definition. SQL injection refers to the injection attack where an attacker tries to execute malicious payloads. What you can say, a payload is nothing but a carrier of malicious activities. For example, any piece of code which may induce an attack on the server side is called as a payload. So basically, SQL injection refers to an attack where the attacker injects payloads onto a website or a web server using some SQL statements. Basically, the attacker bypasses the website authentication using some statements which remotely or directly interacts with the SQL database at the backend. As we all know, websites are being designed to interact with the databases from 2 or 3 decades back. So what we can say is this vulnerability is one of the oldest and the most dangerous of web application vulnerabilities which is existing till date. So let's see a common example how a website looks like where it accepts the username and password and does the authentication at the backend. See this example. The simple query, select name from user. User is nothing but the table name, where username is so-and-so, which is passed using the post commands. And similarly, password is password, which is again passed using the post command. So let's go to a website. It's a really beautiful website, which is basically designed to see how SQL injection works. This is the environment shown. Let me show you back. Let me show you the page which actually provides this SQL injection demo. Let's check this out. This is the website. I'll be showing it in this particular tutorial video how to actually perform an SQL injection. This is basically a demo website which is based on some queries which will actually show you how SQL injection works. see this over here. This is the piece of code. What it actually does is, we are expected to give this username, and this is the password with which the actual authentication will happen. But what if we want to bypass this authentication? What are the various techniques by which we can bypass it? I will show you in detail how to do it, but first see how it works. See, this is the page. I know the username is admin from here, and let's see the actual password, which is admin123. It should work, obviously. Yeah, you have logged in. Go back to login. So this is the actual username and password, so we are able to log in. Now let me try with a fake one or any wrong value. I'm simply typing admin only. It should not work because the password will not match with the actual password. Yes, invalid username or password. So how actually we can bypass this? This is what constitutes the SQL injection attack. See over here, there is one string given. Let me paste it instead of the password which was given earlier, which is admin123. Let me see if I'm able to log in. I'm simply pasting it over here. Ideally, we shouldn't be able to log in because we are entering an incorrect password. The actual password is admin123, but we are entering something else. So ideally we should not get logged in. Let's see what we can see over here. We have actually logged into the server. That shouldn't happen. So why are we able to log in? Let me explain you the code in detail. See, I have broken down the SQL code into two scenarios, the normal scenario and the vulnerable scenario. Let's see both of the scenarios in detail. I've actually done it in color coded format so as to make it more easy for you to understand. The query is something like this: select name from user where username is this and password is this, so and so. So basically this value of username and this value of password are sent through this particular GUI or through this interface using the post method or post command. You all might be aware of the post value. See over here, app.post. So we are sending it using the post method. You could also use get, but we are not going to detail into get and post methods. So let's stick with post. So we are sending the values using the post method over here in between the red quotation marks. Okay, so this is the value of the username and this is the value of the password. This is the normal scenario. But what happens in a vulnerable scenario is the username is same, the password value is now getting changed. I have simply copied this value from the piece of code given over here and pasting it over here between the red quotation marks or apostrophe marks, double quotes. So basically what is happening over here, let's have a look. If you can see carefully, what exactly happening is this black quotation mark and this black quotation mark is nothing but this and this. So what we are doing is, in between the two red quotation marks, I have added the value from that particular website. This is the exact value. Okay, so now what is happening, if you see it carefully, I'm reading out the query once again. Select name from user where username is username and password is unknown. If you see carefully, this password is accepting values between this single quote and this single quote. Now instead of the last single quote, it is accepting the values between this single quote and this single quote. So what is happening? We are simply breaking the code. We are simply breaking the query. What is happening over here? It is selecting the name from username where so and so is the username and password is unknown. Obviously it is not right, not correct, because the password which we know is, it is admin123. So obviously it is incorrect. So what will happen in such a scenario? The query will be broken down into two parts. Either this will be executed from this to this, and after that immediately it is followed by an OR statement, OR 1 is equal to 1. So basically what will happen, even if you have entered a wrong password over here, it will simply go to the next piece of code, which is an OR statement. So even if you have entered a wrong password over here, it will simply move the execution to the next part of the statement, which is 1 is equal to 1, which is always going to be true. So I guess now you're getting the hang of it. Basically, we have broken down the query into two parts, either this part or this part. The second part is always going to be true in all the situations. So what will happen? Even if I have entered any incorrect password, I will simply get access to the database. So what exactly is happening? We are bypassing the authentication using some simple statements over here. This is how exactly the SQL injection works. So what exactly has happened over here? We have simply passed some special characters in the text box, which is causing the query to break into two parts. The first part is obviously going to be incorrect. The second part will be by default correct, because we are sending a value 1 is equal to 1, which is always going to be true. Getting it? So this is how the attackers break the authentication using simple special character validation technique. Getting it? So how we can avoid it? There are various ways we can by which we can avoid SQL injection. I will tell you one of the simplest ways by which we can avoid getting attacked using SQL injection. It is called as input sanitization. What I mean is, whenever we are expecting input from the user through a text box, what we can do is we can convert any special character into its Unicode or ASCII variant. For example, let's see over here. For example, if I'm talking about a Unicode apostrophe or a single quote mark, that can be converted into an Unicode variant, which is and hash 39 colon semicolon, which simply means that whatever input, whatever special character I'm providing through the text box, it will automatically get converted into its Unicode variant. In this way, what we can do is we can avoid the query getting broken into two parts, and as a result, we can simply stop the SQL injection attack through the browser. Okay, so let's get back to our SQL injection tutorial. So the very first thing which you need to do is you need to start up your Kali machine, which I have already done. As we know that Kali has got bundled applications which come pre-installed. So let's have a look. These are the various applications we can see in Kali. The one which we want today is inside this database assessment folder. You can see at the bottom SQL map. So simply click on it. We are going to use this free tool SQL map to carry out our experiment for the day. Okay, so let's see how this particular tool looks like first. These are the various commands, minus h for help, v for version, verbose, etc. What we need to do is, the very first command which we need to fire is, if you are running it in Kali, then you need not do the step number 1. Whereas step number 1 is installation process of SQL map only for Linux based machines which are not having SQL map pre-installed. Okay, so right now we are using Kali, so we will simply omit that step. Skip that step to step number 2. Okay, so right now we are having this particular piece of code. What we need to do is, we simply need to type SQL map followed by minus u, again that stands for URL, followed by the complete URL of the web page which we want to check whether it is SQL vulnerable or not. The very first thing which you need to do is, you need to check whether a particular website is vulnerable or not. So let's do this. Copy this particular URL, go to your address bar, paste it. This seems to be a simple straightforward website without any much styling and so. What we can do is simply put a single quote at the end of the URL. And let's see how the website reacts to it. you see some error over there. You have an error in your SQL syntax. Check the manual that corresponds to your MySQL server version. So and so. The most important thing is this particular thing, which is error is present at line number 74. What exactly this particular thing conveys is, as I told in the previous few videos also, that this particular error is not intentional. What exactly happens is, if you simply put a single quote at the end of the URL, what this particular website is showing as an error should not be shown to the user, because what exactly is happening, you are able to interact with the database with a single special character at the end of the URL. This is what we saw in the previous video also, that special characters, if not addressed properly, may lead to some errors. So this is how an SQL vulnerable website, SQL injection vulnerable website looks like if we pass on some special characters at the end of the URL. So now we came to know that this particular website is prone to SQL injection attacks, and we can carry out any SQL injection attack on this particular site. So now see what is the very next step. After writing the URL of the vulnerable website, we are simply giving a space and typing --dbs. What this will do is, it will copy the entire databases present on the website and show it to you on the GUI or on the console or command prompt. So let's start typing the various commands and see how it reacts to the commands which we are providing into it as inputs. Okay. So very first thing, SQL map minus u, then followed by the URL which we have already copied, I guess. Yes, okay, the entire code copied over here. Okay, so now we are having the statement ready with us. Let's see how this particular website reacts to this command. It's checking whether the connection is proper or not. It's asking me whether you want to skip testing payloads. Okay, you don't want to do it right now. It will carry out the process. It will take some time based upon whether the payloads are being executed properly or not. For this particular experiment, we don't want all the payloads to be executed. So that's why I pressed no over there. It will take some time. In the meantime, let me explain you the remaining code section. After you press this, after you use this particular statement or particular sentence, what is the next step? After you come to know the database name, the very first thing is you should know which databases are present over there. Once you get the name of the database, you can simply start searching for the tables present inside that database. So the remaining portion of the code will remain as it is. What we are doing is, after getting the name of the database, we will simply use a wildcard minus d, which will signify that the database the name which is following this minus d is nothing but the name of the selected database which I have found in step number 2. So minus d followed by the database name which you found in this particular step, followed by --tables. These are all code specific values. You can't write table instead of tables. It is specific, syntactically specific, so you have to write tables only and not table. Okay, so --tables will show you the tables present inside that database which you found in step number 2. In step number 4, what we need to do is, once you get hold of the table name, the next step is you need to find the column values. So next step is --- columns, and at the end, after finding out the column name, what you need to do is, you will simply dump the values you obtain in the particular column. So instead of showing some specific value, what you can do is, you can simply type in dump. Dump will display all the values present inside that particular column belonging to the particular table which we found in step number 3, which is in turn present inside the database which you found in step number 2. So let's get back to our console and see whether it's done or not. So okay, again, see, it's done over here. Step number 2 is complete. So let's see what are the various databases present over here. The first one is ACUART and the second one is information schema. So let me clarify one thing over here. Information schema is not a database. It's basically the entire structure of the other databases present inside that website. So it is just similar to a master database, which will be having information about all the other actual databases. So the database on which we actually want to perform our experiment is this particular database, which is called as ACUART. So let's now jump into our step number 3, which is 90% same. Let's see. Now we don't want this minus minus DBS because we have come to know that the database name is ACUART. So I will simply type minus D, which stands for databases, type in the name of the database followed by minus minus tables. This will give me the various tables present inside the database ACUART. Again, it will take some time. So approximately 2 minutes later, we came to know that the various tables present inside the database ACUART are something like this: artists, cards, category, featured, guest book, pictures, products, and users. So can you tell me which is the table which is having the utmost importance in terms of hacking? For example, if I am a hacker and I wish to get the information about particular users, for example, their password, their other credentials, which is the table which I should be attacking the very first? Yes, is the users table, because users will be having the ID, user ID, the password, and various other information about particular users. So let's see, if I want to select this particular table users, what is the code for it? The rest of the things will remain same. Now instead of minus minus tables, I will simply write in minus T. T stands for tables. Type in the name of the table, which is users, minus minus columns or hyphen hyphen columns. So now the columns present inside the users table will be displayed accordingly. Okay, so we can see that the various columns present inside the table users are something like these: address, cart, CC, email, name, pass, which stands for password, I guess, phone, and username. So what is the very next step? What we can do next? You can select any particular column and dump the values present in the column. So how to do it? Let's see. Now instead of minus minus columns, I will simply select minus C followed by minus minus dump. Sorry, the name of the column followed by minus minus dump. So for example, I wish to select the username. So it will be uname followed by minus minus dump. Okay, so after entering the command, this is what we got as the output. As it's clearly evident that there is only one column, there is only one value present inside the uname column, which is known as test. So right now what we got is, we got the username. So the very next step is, we also want to find out the password corresponding to that username. So again, we will be repeating the similar steps. Instead of uname, I would simply replace it by the column name, which was pass, and press enter. It will again take some time and the output is shown like this. So what we came to know is that the username is test and the password is also test. Very straightforward and very simple website, because it is basically developed for testing purpose. So let's go to the actual website and try this up. So I guess, yeah, over here username is test and password is test. Press enter. Obviously, we are going to get authenticated because we are entering the same values which are present on the database. If you pay close attention to what's written in the website, you can simply see that they have also they have already mentioned that the username is test and the password is test. So this is the simplicity of this particular website. That's why we are using it for our testing purpose, because everything we do over here is official and everything we do over here is legal, because this particular website is basically designed for testing purpose. Okay, so this was the very last step of the SQL map experiment. We can do n number of things using this particular SQL map tool, but we have to stick to our scope, which is detection of SQL injection vulnerabilities in a website database using SQL map. We have done it so far. You can obviously explore the tool, create your own SQL statements. You can try a different kind of SQL statements, for example, update query, select statement, delete statement, insert statement, and so on. So that's it for this particular experiment.